of it and I am trying to isolate the vascular bundle, complete vascular bundle. Now if you want to approach the quadrilateral plane, it has to be into that structure. If you take a lateral incision at the ASIS on the outer aspect, you can put your clamps from outside to hold it. You can use a ball pusher. That is a fracture site that you can see there, which is being pushed. And from here, you can also put a posterior plate from inside or put a posterior column screw. You dissect completely the iliac crest from the inner table. Now what is important here is you can take the, you can osteotomize the ASIS, and once you osteotomize this ASIS, the window that is created gives you a very very large space. Transverse fractures, all fractures lateral to the iliopectoral fascia. And this shows the osteotomy being done. I prefer to put a screw halfway down through the hole created and then osteotomize it. That is the osteotomized piece, and from here you can go down to the anterior part as well. You may require to release the rectus femoris and then put a plate in the inside part of the brim. Now, coma approach. Here, the medial ilioinguinal approach. It is the same where it was described as a modified approach, wherein you take the element of stopa into that by going through the rectus. Now this is a paraxial incision, two fingers above the pubic symphysis. A transverse incision, many people prefer a vertical incision. Be careful not to go very high. Now the important point here is, it is not how much long this incision is, but it is important how much subcutaneously you dissect upwards so that you get a good flap margin. Another 1 minute I just finished. The two recti. Putting a finger so that I will pack in the ridges space to protect the bladder. The beauty of this approach is that both the recti can be elevated superiorly right up to the anterior surface of the ramus. I just try to show the corona mortis. That I was ligating. Now once you ligate the corona mortis, the whole of the inner pelvis, right from the SI joint up to the pubic symphysis, everything is clear in front of you. One approach that we use is a combined approach, stopa with the iliofemoral, where you do an osteotomy of the ASIS to give you a large exposure. Thank you.
And at the outset, I'd like to thank the organizers, Dr. Shivraj, Shivraj Nayak, and Dr. Sen, for inviting me here, and Dr. Devan, a good friend of mine. So my topic is on the fixation techniques of anterior wall and column fractures, which are rare injuries, not very common, and they comprise about 6% of the acetabular fractures. So today's learning outcomes include the understanding the anatomy of the fracture, the displacement, the indications for surgery, the approaches, the techniques of reduction, and the methods of fixation of anterior column and wall fractures. In the original classification, Letourneau Judith's classification, the term anterior wall was used for the trapezoidal fragment, which is seen here. I think you can make out. So only 10 cases were reported in the English literature. And the true anterior wall fracture is a morphological variant of posterior wall fracture, just like posterior wall fracture. But there are no specific classifications like a posterior wall fracture. There are no specific classifications for anterior wall fracture. Or there are no specific operative recommendations for anterior wall fractures. So the anterior column fractures can be classified into three types. Low column, mid column, this is mid column, and the high column fractures. High column fractures, they extend to the iliac crest, up to the iliac crest, and it can break into many pieces as well. Isolated anterior wall fractures are very rare, very rare. And the low anterior column, usually these column fractures are associated or are a part of a complex fracture pattern like posterior hemitransverse fractures or transverse fracture with anterior fracture, everything. It's a part of the complex pattern of acetabular fractures. And the low anterior column fractures frequently will have a component of quadrilateral surface of acetabulum. So you should be very careful, because if you do not reduce the quadrilateral component player, then the instability persists even after fixation. The biomechanics, how do they get displaced? See, this fragment, that is anterior column fragment, usually gets displaced anteriorly, medially, and it will have a sort of an external rotation component. And it may be incomplete, can be associated with a hemitransverse component like this. This is the posterior hemitransverse component. And most of these fractures are associated with anteromedial domain fraction. Not like posterior wall fractures where you see marginal impaction. Here it is anteromedial dome impaction. So well, after thorough evaluation, do a CT scan and all thorough evaluation, you need to decide. The treatment is based on this factors. You should know whether the hip is stable or unstable. Whether the hip is, head is congruous with the acetabulum or not, the degree of comminution, or is the fracture operable or not, and the approaches, you need to plan approaches and that. So principally, what is the thing you need to get anatomic impaction to get a good functional result? And they are treated like intra-articular fractures. Principle remains same. The indications, when do you operate these fractures, anterior column and wall fractures? The most important thing is there should be a displacement of more than 2 mm or a step of 2 mm and a gap of more than 5 mm. So if there is a gap of more than 5 mm, this needs internal fixation. Of course, you need to measure all these roof arc measurements. And after thorough evaluation again, so once you decide to do the surgery, you need to plan the equipment, instruments. Which was shown, Farabook, most important equipment, instrument you use is Farabook, jungle clamps. The picador or the ball spike pusher, very important. And plate bending forceps, retractors. And this is how they are being used. You should know how to use these instruments. Please learn to use this. I don't know how many of you here operate acetabular fractures routinely. most important aspect of, you know, operating an established hatchery is you should know how to use the instruments and equipments on the boat. So coming to the approaches, anterior wall fractures, most, you know, it's approached by anterior approach, either iliofemoral or iliofemoral sometimes, which cannot go beyond the pelvic plane, or the Smith-Wilson approach. And I routinely use the ilioinguinal approach, which is more versatile, and it gives access to this muscle. You can see that, you know, the complete anterior column is being, you know, exposed by either you can expose the complete until the pubis or ischiopubic ramus as well. And if you need, if there is a single large anterior component extending to the iliac crest only, you can use the ilioinguinal. And it can also be used to visualize the joint. If there is an intra-articular debris, you need to dislocate, you can use the iliofemoral approach. And Smith-Peterson approach for anterior wall fractures, very few fractures, only wall fractures you can use when you are using a small fragment set. And the techniques of reduction, the most important step is traction. You need to give traction in two directions. One is lateral traction, and the second one is longitudinal traction. Putting a pin, chance pin in the trochanter is a must for reduction of these fractures. So how to reduce? Fracture reduction starts from periphery. Remember, you should start the reduction from the iliac crest downwards and posterior to anterior. If there is fracture more posteriorly, fix that fracture first, then come anterior. So use a therapist, because anterior column fracture is, you know, rotated. This place. So use a therapist. Manipulate the anterior column fragment as shown here. And then you can also use a ball spike. Push the fragments with the ball spike. But you need to be careful. You can extend the fracture lines with the ball spike. And you can also use screws to fix the high anterior column fractures. Next is, you know, even with fixation of the iliac portion, there might be an instability due to quadrilateral plate fractures, which should be held by offset clamps. So one time over the anterior inferior iliac spine outside, another time over the pelvic frame or the quadrilateral plate. This is how you use the, so this will be assisted by traction. So you can see the inline traction of before reduction and after reduction, means after traction. Fracture gets reduced. Most of the trapezoidal fracture fragments, it gets reduced with this inline traction. With, you know, it should be assisted by the clamps, but it's very difficult to apply these clamps unless you practice. Try to put these clamps through the middle window to reduce the quadrilateral plate. Sometimes clamps used can come in the way of fixation of plates. You should be careful with that also. So once you reduce, once you manipulate, reduce all this, you have to contour the plate to fit the anterior column over the plate. And then pass it beneath the vascular pedicle, the iliosus, and then fix it proximally distally. So ideally you should fix it proximally first, then with the help of a ball spike, push the plate over the pubis, and then fix the plate distally. This is how the completion of fixation of plate near the pubic fracture towards complete anterior column fixation. If there is a quadrilateral plate, you know, fracture, you can also fix it through a modified stopas. Modified stopas with the lateral window as shown earlier. This is an example. So you can see the fractures from top to bottom. Anterior high anterior column, mid column. This is the mid column fracture. So there are six segments. Actually, the mid fragment is like it's floating completely, which was exposed as by ilioinguinal approach. I think you know all these windows, three windows. Then this is what you have to create a proper window so that there is enough space to put these instruments and equipments. Then this is the reduction techniques. You can see the plate being placed inside, screws, and gen glue. How to use the gen glue? To use two screws, if there is a gap, compress that, you can reduce the fragments. and confirm the reduction under fluoroscopy. This is how the post-op is done. So anterior palm isolated injuries, there are some examples fixed only by the anterior plate, and I would like to go to other techniques. So anterior palm with posterior metastasis. This is one of the most common fracture, but usually this fracture, you can see the posterior hemitransverse component, and this fracture is usually associated with domain. This is independent of the anterior and posterior column fracture fragments, and it does not get reduced by reducing the column fractures. So what you need to do is, you need to identify where the impaction is and plan to open that impaction. There are two ways of opening the impaction site. One is, you can make an independent iliac particle window, or you can go through a pre-existing fracture of the internal iliac plate of bone. So you first think, disimpact the fracture by traction, and this is how you see after disimpaction and reduction. I'll show you. This side, the fragment is elevated, and this is the site impaction was there, which was pushed with the help of ball spike, and later on pushed with the ball spike like this, fixed with the screw. So impaction should be reduced. It's a difficult task, but you try to identify the antromedial doom impaction. These are the steps seen in the CR. So this is the fragment which is impacted, reduced with the help of a lever here, and a screw was passed to buttress the impaction site. So these are the pictures. This is the X-ray of another patient. Similar X-ray with impaction fixed with multiple plates. This is the first approach. So you need to, I see, whenever you fix these fractures, the pelvis should look symmetric. Unless it looks symmetrical, sorry, I'll take just 1 or 2 minutes. So this is how you fix. And the last technique for fixation of anterior column fractures is percutaneous techniques. It can be used in non-displaced and mildly displaced fractures. But the most important prerequisite is injured acetabulum should have been normal before injury. Means there should not have been an old injury, a malunited fracture and all that. For that you need to use a CT scan. And this is the geometric representation of passing anterior columns. And these are the follow-up X-rays. Here is the X-rays. This is the post-op follow-up CT. And this is another screw used for high anterior column fractures, also called as LC2 screw. You need to take a view called as TP view to pass this LC2 screws. And these are the different ways of putting percutaneous screws. So I think with this short time we have understood the basic anatomy of the fracture, displacements, indications, approaches, which already been taught, you know, told by Dr. Kade, and techniques of reduction, and 3 methods of fixation of anterior column fractures. So to conclude, extra-articular approach reduction, and it is entirely by indirect means. You are not exposing the acetabulum in this approach. And stable reduction is a very important thing beneath the femoral bone. Quadrilateral surface is the biggest portion which should be reduced properly, otherwise there will be instability centrally, you know, it can dislocate to the central flexion of the patient's canal. And anatomic reconstruction is a must to give good functional results. So thank you very much for patient listening.
On both column, Dr. Raju has very beautifully elaborated all those points. Why associated both column is different than most other fractures, that this has a different management in the form of conservative also. Very specifically, the only fracture pattern which gives us secondary congruence. And in the past, all our seniors have been saying that these fractures do not need surgery because they are always talking about this fracture pattern, which has got a secondary congruence in many of these cases, and it gives reasonably good result. Now, if we are operating upon This has got its specific pattern of displacement, where you can always see that all the fracture fragments move with the femur head, and it can fit little more medially, little more up, but usually they remain congruent. There are two, three patterns. This is a classical, which you have seen in the earlier x-rays also, the classical pattern of an associated both column fracture, where there is one main fragment which stays attached with the sacrum. There is an anterior fragment which is attached with the pubis or separated from the pubis, which actually takes the femur head along with it. And there is a third fragment, which is the posterior column, which remains separate and in this scenario usually goes along with the femur head to an extent. So these are the three basic displacements which we can define. I won't go into the detail. But what is most important is all acetabular surface is separated from the main column. Now in all other fractures, part of the acetabulum stays with the main, so we need to reduce all the fragments to that very fragment. Here everything is displaced, so everything in unison has to be brought down to the main fragment, that is. Now these are two patterns. This either T-shaped or Y-shaped, the two factor. What the difference here is that in Y-shaped, the fracture starts from the higher, from the iliac crest. And the anterior fragment is quite big. You can hold, you can manipulate it. In contrast to the lower fragment, where it goes down, you can see now your ability to manipulate the lower fragment is relatively limited. And your approach also differs. While in the left side, if you look at the bigger fragment, you have to access laterally. You are likely to go with the iliac inguinal and the lateral windows. While on the other side, you will have to stay primarily with the Stopa's approach or a lower level of iliac inguinal approach in this kind of a situation. So in the high fracture, as I just talked about it, we will have an extension up till up, and then we go to the down, and this is the kind of the spectra where you can see that all the fragment over the acetabulum is actually moving along with the femur head. And this is again less displaced fracture, more displaced fracture. Once we come down, it can come to the middle level also, and where you can have a displacement which may be less. And then this is the lower part. Here the fracture has come quite low down, and this is the level of the displacement where really you don't need to open up, reach the iliac crest also, because it's not involved in that part of it. Now the Stopa's approach is likely to be more important in this kind of a situation. You look at this displacement, it has nothing to do with the upper part of it, is primarily down there. Here it's primarily up in here and here, here. So here you can manipulate a bit, but primary displacement you have to come down. And here you can see the same fracture pattern over here, which is primarily localized to the lower part of it. The upper part remains intact, but all parts of the acetabulum are actually separated out from the main fragment. I just talked about the various approaches. As was told by Dr. Raju, this lateral traction is the key. Because all the fragments have gone between, the lateral traction pin can reduce most of these fragments. And in a fresh fracture, then it will not an issue. As you give it traction, all the fragments tend to fall back with each other into the respective area. If it is a higher level of fracture and the fracture is involving over here, you will definitely have to reduce this part of it, because maybe it is reduced by traction, but you will have to do a finer manipulation at that stage to get this fragment back. And in that scenario, the first step starts from the lateral window to get orientation of the iliac in this procedure. And once you have realigned it, thereafter you stabilize it with a kind of this thing. Then, next step, after you have done this thing, you come down to the lower level of the crest, where you fix the anterior fragment with the posterior fragment, or you fix the anterior column as such. In this fixation, you will have to come down to those very fragments which get fractured over here, reduce them back, and once you have held it, the upper part, the lower part, then you tend to pass the specific wires from this side to this side. You hold this fragment, you hold this fragment, and then you stabilize with a wire or with a screw into this area, just like I am holding over here, and I am passing this screws in the LC corridor, LC2 corridor over here, which stabilizes the upper part of it and brings our focus down to lower part of it. So in this high gap of associated bone column fracture, this fixation then coming over to this fixation realigns. Now, as I told earlier, most of the femur had failed with the anterior column. So once this is done, the femur head comes down to its anatomical position. That is the most important part of it here. And then you can apply your plate over the brim and your femur head comes down. Now stays the question of a posterior part of it. Usually because it is an associated, so it can also be reduced. At this stage, if you are, you can use a bono, you can use a collinear reduction clamp to get this fragment back into position. That is your next step in this kind of a situation. And if it is much more immediate displacement, you can push out laterally also by application of these clamps, which you can cross-check with the image, and when you think you have been able to achieve it out, you can get screws across from the upper part to the lower part into this direction. Your screws are likely to hold it up, and these screws, especially stabilizing the posterior column, do have its specificity over here, where you can go straight down or you can have the obliquity from this area, avoiding this area which is the sternal surface inside it. And that way, your fixation screws are likely to go across the posterior column and the quadrilateral plate in this kind of a situation, and that is likely to be the eventual outcome of this kind of a posterior column fracture in the follow-up of a plate and then getting a screw across into the posterior column, and that is the outcome of this kind of a situation. Now, you may be able to hold, or we previously used to use a buttress plate to stabilize this quadrilateral plate also to get an anatomical reduction. But we have to appreciate it, this primary displacement, which can subsequently end up in this kind of a situation. We can use another kind of a buttress to hold the lateral side of it, which can get its stability and get the fragments or a T-clamp or T kind of a situation over there. But it's very important to have a reduction along with it. Now, many times, along with the associated both column fracture, posterior wall fracture is also there. Now, when you are approaching from anterior side, you can pass a screw from here into this wall. Maybe you can use a ACL jig or something kind of a thing, and you can pass a screw from anterior side. Now, here is the posterior wall. You get this reduction, you pass this clamp, reduction clamp, and can pass a screw to hold. This posterior wall is different than the posterior wall what we get in a classical posterior wall fracture. Here, this screw from anterior side to posterior side can hold reduction once you are stabilizing the pointed reduction clamp. Now, if there is a posterior comminution, now that makes it difficult, and in this kind of a scenario, you might have to get to the posterior side also. So, you might have to use a double approach, front and back in this kind of a situation. Just like here, first there was a combination, it was difficult to get, so I went posteriorly stabilizing, then I came anteriorly to put the plates on the anterior side of it. And if there the fracture is relatively old, then we used the extended iliofemoral approach also in this kind of a situation to get the reduction. This is a difficult pattern of the associated bone column fracture when the fracture is just nearby. In this kind of a fixation, extensive dissection is required. But most of these cases required with the more extensive, you can see lot of comminution posteriorly, lot of comminution anteriorly, and your plates tend to get multiplied in this area to get each fragment. This is 7 months follow-up. Then we devised a plate initially, and this was the old plate which we have designed, which is giving a good fixation in this kind of a situation. But lately we have designed a new plate for this area, which is a anatomical plate for this, and here you can see it out. If you do a reduction and then you put a plate, this is the posterior part, and as soon as you put a plate, it buttresses everything, it gives a good reduction with this plate and gives a good outcome subsequently. Another case, you can see the amount of a comminution in this kind of a situation, but when you start reduction, you go stepwise and thereafter you apply the plate and then you can get a good outcome subsequently in this kind of a. Another case, extensive comminution, you can see it over. And then if you go further, you apply the plate, everything buttresses around, you can see around over that area to give a reasonably good reduction, and this is the eventual outcome. Another patient, again, for this thing, I'll just go over. What the outcome says, if you look, these are the publications which we have done, if you look at the outcome, you do get best possible outcome when you compare all other different kind of a fracture pattern, you get the best possible outcome with the associated both column fractures in these cases. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
treat the unstable pelvis and disposition of pelvic fractures appropriately. So before starting, just I would like to give a case scenario, just example of a scenario which we have faced. One day all of our junior resident had gone for strike. That day I received a call from the senior PG, who was the only one who was looking after the cases in emergency ward, and he told he received a patient with hypotension and a run over of a vehicle over his abdomen. So I asked him to show it to general surgery people. He told they have seen the patient and they told abdomen is soft. So and case is not, doesn't belong to them. Then he told what to do. I told, oh, don't worry, first you start the start up with the your regular treatment, then you will see. I asked him to start with 2 points of blood immediately. He arranged, and whole night a patient came at 8 o'clock. Whole night he observed, he followed up. By morning patient was fine, patient was conscious, well oriented, BP was 100 by 106 by 70. Then I requested the surgery person, who though there was a strike, they are not bothered to even do an examination. They are telling only abdomen is soft, and that day ultrasound was not working. So see, this is a scenario you will face in a case hospital, big hospitals and very teaching hospitals. So importance is, basic importance in this polytrauma patient is ultrasound, a basic tool, important tool. That's what we will discuss about the fast focused assessment of sonography of the trauma. That's more important. So here are the two things. One is the stabilization of the patient and stabilization of fracture. They are all, both are interdependent. If you want to stabilize the fracture, the patient has to be stable for the surgery. And to make the patient stable, you have to fix it. So it's a, we have to weigh the things which you only have to decide. So it's more important to assess the patient. The initial assessment of the patient is very important. So these pelvic fractures constitute around 20-25% of the all polytrauma patients, and 19% of mortality is noted in these patients. So most of the things, you know, these are, there may be intra-abdominal injuries which can cause hypotension. We have to assess and proceed. So simple anatomy, what we have to learn about the pelvic fracture is the structures behind. So the, for the stability of the these pelvic ring fractures, these posterior structures, sacrotuberous ligament, sacrospinous ligament, and sacrospinous ligament, and the posterior sacroiliac ligament, these are all important structures which will say whether the fracture is stable or not. It's more than anterior, it is a posterior ring which is important whether the fracture is stable or not. For your fixation, say anteriorly, the anatomy were well versed. The posterior important zone is this. This is the more, the line what I am marking, my where my cursor is moving. This is the area where you can use your screws, a safe zone. Below you will have foramen, more anterior you have got lot of vessels, more posterior you have got canal. So it is a very narrow zone which is important for your sacral spine fixation. And this area also, lateral to the foramen, this is also a safe zone for your any fixations, a plate fixation or anything. So coming back to the source of the blood loss, I don't want to go in detail. As it is a workshop related talk, just I will emphasize mainly on the some important tips where you have to learn about these fixation techniques and how to manage this primary management of the pelvic fractures. Considering classification, they started earlier with the Lutenel, where he classified according to anatomy, then piles, then All many people have come, Young and Progress Corporation, which is considered by Infrastructure Study and all those things. Then best one is the Young's Worker Classification, which helps in your assessing the stability of the rain. Again, sacral zones are there. This is a safe zone. It's more where the foramina come. Again, this is also both these two zones are difficult fractures. Laterals are easy to manage. So there is basically three types: anterior posterior compression fractures, lateral compression fractures, and shear fractures. So just I will run out the, all these X-rays. So mechanism of injury is high trauma, high energy traumas, hit by a car, fall from the height, all those things are the most common injuries. So defining the instability, the loss of posterior ring integrity often leads to instability. Loss of anterior ring integrity may contribute to instability and may be a marker for posterior ring injury. Tight classification scheme based on instability pattern. Loss of posterior ring integrity often leads to instability. Loss of anterior ring integrity may contribute to the instability and may be marker for posterior ring injury. Tight classification scheme based on the instability patterns. So initial assessment of the patient is important. Again, here a primary survey, secondary survey, what you follow for a trauma patient, you have to follow for this patient. Forget about the fixation. First you stabilize the patient, then you think. Here the patient shifting itself is a problem. If you shift the patient repeatedly, you may end up in a problem. So always you should be careful. First you have to stabilize the patient hemodynamically. Assess the patient hemodynamically. Again here the same thing goes with HABC, hemorrhage, first stop hemorrhage, then airway, then breathing, all those things what you follow for the trauma patient, polytrauma patient you have to follow. Then you go for the assessment of the stability. So compression test and distraction test will give you impression of what type of fracture is there. Then initial imaging, again FAST is very important to assess the intra-abdominal injuries and also to assess the stability. Then X-rays, again it should be portable X-rays. Portable X-rays taken, try to minimize the X-rays as much as possible, but to assess which type of, if the patient is stable, totally stable, hemodynamically, then you can go for inlet-end, outlet-end and all those things. But see the patient condition and then plan it. Simple radiograph. Inlet view, so you can see each view different, where you can see the inlet view, the entry port and outlet view, you can see the sacrum properly. So oblique views. So this table gives a fair idea about which views will help you. I don't want to go in more detail. A CT scan will definitely help. A 3D reconstruction definitely help in assessing the these fractures. So applying a splint, more important, it should give a compression. Even you can bind the two, you can see the limb, they are empassed. You have to tie the legs also together. You have to give a binding like this. You can put a weight also and stabilize it in the beginning. Non-operative management, I don't want to go in detail. Operative principles. First assess if the patient is stable, patient ring is stable or not. If unstable, there are important approaches, anterior approach, Stouffer's approach you can see. Already which has been discussed in detail, you can place a plate anteriorly or you can basic simple treatment is X-fix, which can be done under local anesthesia. Three pins either side posted behind the your ASIS through the electrest. Three pins either side and you can fix the stabilize with the axial fixators. These are the iliac screws, sacroiliac screws, posteriorly these are the important plate. You can see the positioning, it should be vertically down, not it's stable, this type of fixation is stable, not anterior, posterior or retrograde, whatever is there, it's from the superior to down. That will stabilize these fragments. Already these tools have been already discussed for the ramming fractures. So it can be fixator, can be anterior, posterior, axial fixators, depending upon the stability, which one is where you want to use. These are some X-rays of posterior fixation. So again, I have highlighted. I told you important thing is the placement of the sacroiliac screws. Here it needs a CT scan and complete assessment of the anatomy of the sacrum. Whether it is the sacculation of the lumbar vertebra is there, then it's very difficult to place the screw because the anatomy, the bending of the bone is more and the zone, safe zone is less. Just go through the X-rays. So, conclusion, complex constellations of injuries, treatment based on the confluence understanding of the potential beliefs, ring instability, displacement, assault injuries, survival of technique, surgical techniques for reduction and stabilization continue to evolve. And most of these, whatever the fixation, they are just I want to control some of the centers perform pre-operative packing and all those things. Sir, does it have time for another 1 minute?
Go ahead, sir.
Okay. So, important is again, along with the laparotomy, you can do embolization and all those things, packing the patient. These are all more important. Rather than the fixation of the stabilization of the fractures, if a simple treatment in these fractures is just axial fixator, will stabilize these ring fractures. No need of going for the plating and all those things. But along with that, the stabilization of the patient is more important. That's what I want to highlight here. So, along with that, we have to packing of the abnormal packing, laparotomy and embolization of the major lesions. Those are all important surgical tips you have to learn. And you should not depend always on the surgeons. A simple, for example, a patient comes with a polytrauma with a chest injury and abdominal injury and pelvic fracture, breathing difficulties. So simple needle, if you assess that he has got a tachycardia and all those things, just if he has got tension pneumothorax, just a needle, put a needle on second intercostal space, you can save the patient. So instead, rather than waiting for general surgeon to treat this patient, you as a orthopedic surgeon, you should learn all these simple techniques of intubation, raised tube aspiration, all those things, they can save. We had a patient who was revived completely, but he died of a aspiration. Young patient died of a aspiration because intubation was not done, raised tube thing was not put, simple thing. So these are all simple tips you should learn. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Patel.
There will be a posterior fracture also, which will be transverse. So anterior column fracture, the line will be like this, and there will be line like that of the posterior column. So that is classically anterior column with posterior fracture. A fracture here. Their main fracture line is transverse, and secondary fracture line goes down. So main fracture line, secondary fracture line, main displacement, and is up and down, and down is to what displaced. But the anterior column main fragment is anterior, and non-comminuted fracture is posterior. So when we talk about anterior column posterior hemitransverse, usually comminution of the anterior part, non-comminuted posterior part. That is the basic perspective. In this basic perspective, now we understand the force was anterior by that. So our retraction, our this thing has to be from the anterior side. Usually our approach will be anterior only. Now as told, our 2-3 anterior approaches, we have to look at anterior column. Anterior column means, I told you, a fracture around here. There could be a comminution around this part. Now this comminution of this area, how to access? Our standard right now, because we are using more and more Stopa's approach, and with the Stopa's approach we are liking to see like this. So this gives us a whole of the anterior column in one window. Here we were looking at three different windows to get an access. Here we have got just one window in which we can access everything. And many a time our fragment is like this. This or this, and then this is a transverse fracture. This goes like this also, this goes like this also, and this one. So now if I have to reduce this thing, if I am using a lateral window, I can access, if this my anterior fracture goes line up, I'll have to reduce it, I'll have to use a lateral window. So once this is done, subsequently now we have to imagine. Now if this is a displacement, head has gone inside it, so this will be little tilted like this. Once I reduce it, I have to stabilize here, and once it is reduced, I have to put my own, this thing is, I put two screws or thick K wires here after I have fixed up this area. So I fixed up this area with the K wire, thick K wire or screw. I subsequently push it down, and then I stabilize here with the two thick K wires as a temporary, and subsequently two long screws, 80-90, this thing over this area. So this area is stabilized. Now my problem stays here. This area, I cannot get it from the iliofemoral approach because it's much more medial. It is iliofemoral approach which gives me access to this area. And then I have to this area. But because right now that was a standard, with the Stopa's approach, after this is done, now I get access to whole of it. So the trend world over is right now increasing to Stopa's approach from the conventional iliofemoral. Incidentally, whatever new developments are happening, if you have seen the Stopa's video from Stryker, they are all with the Stopa's approach. In AO also, most of the latest developments which are happening is by the Stopa's approach. Perception that you are able to see the anterior column fully, and you can access the posterior column. Here when we were doing iliofemoral approach, for this fixation we used to put a screw like this to hold the posterior column. Here now we can put a plate here with the Stopa's approach only. So Stopa is being done more frequently now, and for me in my practice, for all these anterior column fracture, I use right now a Stopa's approach, and wherever needed I might have to use a lateral window. But as Dr. Parekh was, when you need an extensive Stopa's, I get rest of the place. So I have complete access to whole of the anterior column and access directly to the posterior column from this side, and for fixation from this side. So anterior column posterior hemitransverse fractures, what I am perceiving, a part of the acetabulum to be intact here, and I have to bring this thing back and this thing back to this part. So my this thing is that I'll first reduce it as you should by putting a stem and pin over here, the shank pin over here, and give a traction. This will bring this back. I have done this thing. Now I go from the Stopa's approach and try to reposition. When I am accessing this place, I am just looking at this thing. How to get access? You need retractors. These Stryker people have got beautiful retractors. They are very costly. They are carbon made. So what we do is, you use simple Bowman retractor with a broad this thing, and you go over to this place and dig into it. And we retractors do must have this kind of a serrated end, and then they go back. So you use a K wire, over that K wire put that serrated end. So that serrated end will not allow you to move around, and you get a reasonable exposure. So your one of the retractors go to, you can go to this area, but it is sometimes difficult, till you do not release the iliopectoral fascia from inside over here. In iliofemoral approach, you release it from this side, In Stoppa's approach, you release it from this side. So this way your vessels remain safe and you are able over here. Again the same way, you have the Homan, put it over there. Third retractor, you will have to go initially to this area. If you are staying lateral to the operator vessel, you go to this area. Yeah. The vessels are going now, around this place. Yeah. So now, this way you release over here and we go over here. And but this, because the vessels are bound in the this fascia, so you have to release the fascia. Otherwise vessel will have a lot of kinking, then limb has to be flexed also. So that way you have released it, the point of flexion, your access to this area becomes easier. Second, you have to get access to this area. You can make little bigger. The retractor here, now there are two things. Here we have an operator vessel going like this. Operator nerve also going like this. If I have to retract, go down, I cannot go down and retract it too much. I have to be very careful. So if I need, if there is any fracture which is coming like this, I don't have to go down. I can just have this much of it and stabilize it. But if there is a fracture lower down, which can happen in an anterior column with a posterior hemi transfer, now I have to go medial to the operator vessel. So I have to release them away from this area, come down and put my retractor down to the lesser shaded part. Again, what kind of a retractor to use? Here you have to take primary care of the bladder. So here you use a long with a broad kind of a surface, which you have to go down and hold all the bladder around this area. Let the vessel